Right, so let me start with some motivation for the security motivation behind information flow control. And today's modern software is being built in many ways, but there is something common that is like usually you have a user that interacts with a big system. And then, you know, that big system has some persistent storage, which is a database. And surely, you know, it has connectivity to internet because it's 2021, right? And in this setting, of course, you want that connectivity because you want to fetch a lot of resources from the internet. Or you want to communicate with some other services, right? And the challenge we have is like the user will provide some information to the system that will go to the persistent storage. Sometimes that's information is not super relevant. It could be like, you know, your height, but sometimes it could be like something super sensitive, like the credit card number of the user, right? So in this setting, it's not clear that that information that you send and it was written in the persistent storage will not leak into the internet, right? So how do you have that guarantee that information is not being leaked? For that, we need to kind of consider, you know, more in detail how systems are developed today. And yeah, we have like, you know, a system, a bunch of pieces put together, right? And those pieces, let me just put in a more comfortable way on the screen. And those pieces have been written by different developers with different styles, different approaches, right? And perhaps one of those developers is malicious, you know, it's a malicious developer. And here is going to be our ninja friend, right? And I choose the logo of a ninja because who would trust a ninja, right? So, yeah. So in this setting, if we repeat the exercise as we did before, you know, you send sensitive information to the system, to the module, and then you want to be sure that that information doesn't get into the module of the ninja, and then the ninja will leak it to the internet or to his or her services, right? So how can you be sure that that doesn't happen? That when you have a system built with different components written by different people, when the users provide information to the system that is private, that information doesn't leak, right? And this is kind of the main topic of this course, right? To learn how to protect private data when it's manipulated by malicious code, by a code that you not necessarily trust. Yeah, and before we go any further, can someone say like a system, you know, what kind of system works like this? Like it's built with a bunch of different components put all together and you put a lot of private information, a lot of private information. Any guesses?
Like web-based systems, like in which we have multiple, like JavaScripts and HTML and CSS and all these things are working together.
Great. Yeah, that's one. That's my second example. But the first one, do you know, I know that besides web systems, any other system that you usually put it in your pocket all the time?
Like mobile phone and like
that's right like mobile phones, you know, they fit this pattern, right? Exactly, phone apps, that's right. So, and of course, you know, we see more and more highlights on the newspapers where, you know, confidentiality of private data has been broken. So yeah, and it's just the tip of the iceberg. These news are a bit old. But you know, if you look highlights today in the newspapers, you will see like there are many, many problems of the data leakage. Right. So the second example, as I don't know who was the one saying, but yeah, it's web apps. When you put a lot of when you usually load a web page, you bring into scope a lot of code, JavaScript code, maybe written by different people. I know that code has access usually to all the private data of the user, like the cookies and so on. Right. So yeah, and as you see here, yeah, there are a bunch of vulnerabilities as well in this domain. All right. But you can argue with me like, okay, maybe you are being too pessimistic, you are too paranoid, like you are assuming like, you know, we have an attacker within our developing team, right? A ninja. You can say, well, Alejandro, you know, we're working on a startup, you know, we know all each other, nobody's malicious, right? So in that case, the same, we have the same challenge, like sensitive information can get into your system in one of the modules. But rather than going to the ninja, there is a bug or there is a mistake in the code that leads to leaking the secret, right? So, and that's kind of as well the other challenge that we will talk, that is like how to protect private data when the code as well is manipulated by buggy but not malicious code, right? And what is the difference between how we should think about we want to protect against buggy non-malicious code for or with malicious code when it comes to data leakage, right? It's not the same thing. All right. So before we go any further, let me make something clear. So here's about preserving the private data confined so that it doesn't leak. And usually access control is not a solution for this. It's not enough. Access control is great for many, many things, but it's not enough for data privacy, for avoiding information leakage. And the reason for that is like access control is about who can have access to the information, but it doesn't tell anything what happens after you give access to that information. Right? And data leakage is about, you know, where the information goes and if it goes in a place where, you know, it might leak. Right? So, and that's why, you know, the information flow control area comes into play, which is a research area that talks about and reasons about how information propagates within system. It's not about who has access or not, it's about how it propagates. Okay? And you can see today, you know, you were mentioning like phone apps and so on. Usually, you know, in the phone apps, usually the security system is access control. So you need to give a bunch of permissions. Once you give a bunch of permissions in order to use the app, you are not sure if that information is not being leaked somewhere, right? So, So keep that in mind. Access control is not enough to avoid information leakage. It's a great tool, it's a great security concept, but it's not enough for avoiding data leakage. All right, so in this research area, there is a bunch of tools that they do this tracking of information, how it moves within programs or within systems and detects when information leakage can happen or might happen, right? So we have tools like GIF, that was one of the first ones, it's in Java, right? So you write your Java program and then GIF can track how sensitive information moves within the program and detects that if it goes to places where it should not go. We have Paragon, it's another programming language written in, it's written in Haskell, but the programming language is in Java. That as well reason about how information moves within programs and detect data leakage. GS Flow, for example, is in JavaScript. While the first two were static, so they have a rich type system that avoid information leakage. GS Flow is in JavaScript, so you know JavaScript is a quite dynamic language, so it's very hard to do any static analysis. So then GS Flow has a dynamic enforcement. We have Cowl that I worked on that some years back, which is how we track the data move within, sensitive data move within web pages. And then, you know, there is a bunch of different tools that go from, you know, modifications to web browsers, modifications to the operating system, other proposal of programming languages. So there is a wide range of tools that you can use. And usually the tool that you pick is the one that tells you at which granularity you are tracking how information moves within the system. Are you tracking it at the programming language level? Are you tracking it at the system level? And so on and so forth. And within the whole this ecosystem of tools, We have pure programming languages like Haskell that have like a privileged role because most of the tools that I show you here on all the tools I show you here on the screen, in order to provide this tracking mechanism, how information moves and detect data leakage, requires to modify either the operating system, modify the web browser, modify interpreters, or create new interpreters, or modifies a compiler, or propose new compilers. In Haskell, because it's pure, and we'll go in the details of that, you can provide this tracking mechanism just as a library. So you provide the library, and if the programs are being built following the API of the library, you have certain guarantees that information is not being leaked. Okay, and this is kind of the topic of this course, how to create these libraries and what are the concepts behind these libraries. Right, so yeah, there's a bunch of papers on information flow control via libraries in Haskell, and then you know, I'm an author in all of them. And as I said before, you can there are many libraries for IFC, for information flow control. I would say IFC. It might be, they might track how data moves within programs in a static manner, meaning using the type system. It can be a dynamic manner, how they track the movement of information. And that means that, you know, the library implements a runtime monitor, or it could be a mixture of both, right? And then here I have the names of the libraries I work the most and I'm very familiar with, Mac, HLIO, and LIO, right? And these libraries, they all work more or less the same. And these are kind of the principles that we will learn in this course, okay? And for this course, we will use a static one, Mac, because that's the simplest to present and to play with. But the same concept translates to the other libraries. Any questions so far?
Well, not so no many questions right now. But if it will be, I will be follow up.
All right, great. All right, so before we go into the technical details, so about the organization of the course, what you will learn, you will learn things from information flow control research, and you will learn things as well from the how to create libraries. So it's kind of these two different aspects of the course. And from the information flow control research, you know, you will learn how to express security policies related with the avoiding information leakage. You will manage some foundational aspect of protecting privacy of data and identify limitations in security mechanisms related with information flow control. On the design of the security libraries part, you will learn to identify programming languages concepts that will facilitate the creation of these libraries. You will learn how to write secure code in Haskell, and an idea of how to formalize and prove the correctness of the libraries. This is what I have in mind for the course, but of course, I'm pretty open and we see how everyone is tagging along or how they're following, and then we see we need to adapt some of these goals. Yeah, you have the webpage of the course. In the webpage of the course will be all the code that I'm writing. Right, so yeah, I think the duration of the lecture is 1.5 hours, I believe. So maybe I might we can make a 10 minutes break or finish like 10 minutes before. We see, you tell me how you feel about this. So we are, how do you usually proceed? It's like 1.5 hours in a row, you have a break in between, or how do you usually do it?
Well, normally we don't have, like in the previous lecture, we don't have a break. We just normally finish it in 1 hour, 20 minutes.
Okay.
All the course. So I don't know like how you will proceed, but it's up to you.
Right. Okay. But that's okay. Then we skip the break and then we do like 1 hour, 1 hour 20. If that's what you do here, we can do that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Well, I don't know. We can do a quick reaction. Let me see. Yeah, you can monitor the chat. So yeah, I mean, you can reaction thumbs up or thumbs down if you want a break. Yeah, and I can adapt to that. Then you can tell me later.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So. So we'll have a quick introduction to Haskell. And for this part, let me see. Give me a second. Okay. Can you give me a reaction as well in the chat? Who knows how to program in Haskell? So then I know you know how fast should I go with the next in the next minutes. If you can give me the reaction, you know, crying, well, joy if you don't know, and the heart if you know. All right, so we do quickly. It would be nice to enable the pool feature of Zoom if you have it. So that would be great for the organizers to consider. Here. Okay. So I will go a little bit. Fast then, yeah. So we see. All right. So quick overview. Right, Haskell is a functional programming language. So you can declare functions, and you can see here plus one, where the two column means that you know this is the type of the function. In this case, the function takes an integer and returns an integer. Right, so you can see here, you see my mouse? Yeah, okay, yeah, great, there. And you define plus one x, okay, maybe, let me see if I can, right. So, is that the font okay? Can you see it properly? Which too small?
It's a little small. If you made it one size bigger, that'd be great, I feel. I don't know if I'm speaking for others, but.
Okay, sure. So like this should be enough, right?
This was great. Yeah, this was great.
Yeah.
It's more blurry than small to me. I don't know if it's a screen recording or, yeah, but I can see it now.
Okay, great. Great, okay, guys. So we have, you know, plus one is a function from integer to integer. This is what the types say. And you just write it like this, give me an x, and I give you x plus one. And then, you know, you can go to the console and say plus one, 10, I give you 11, right? So easy. And then Haskell has polymorphism. It means like you can define a function that works for all the types, like this one, that takes, the type of this function is that you take a pair, well, the first components of type A for any type A, and then a B here, right? Over in type B and returns an A, right? So then you can say, well, you can say, and the definitions say, you know, first of a pair, X and Y, then returns an X. So then here, for example, you can say, you know, first, then true, and then it will return 10, right? Yeah, you can do lists, right? So you can, the way that you say, you know, this is the type for list of integers. And this is how I define a list that has element 1, 3, 5. But here I enumerate the list, but here I use the cons and the nil constructor, which are the two list constructors that I have. The nil is the empty list and the cons is a function that you give an element and we put that as the first element in the list. So if we go here, we have like list one, 1, 3, 5, and then we have list two, which is the list with element 7, right? So this is all super basic, but you know, we'll go quickly. But then we have, you know, we will use in this course, we have algebraic data types, where you can just declare data types and the corresponding constructors. Right, in an algebraic manner. Here, for example, you can express your nationality. You are Argentinian or Italian, right? And then based on you can declare now functions using this user-defined data type that says it's called favorite food. If you give me your nationality, I give you the string with the favorite food, right? And if you are Italian, your favorite food will be pasta. Yes, correct me, Italians, if I'm wrong on that. And if you are Argentinian, that's the more I'm most familiar with, your favorite food is asado, which is a barbecue, right? It's a big barbecue. Yeah. So then same thing, you can say favorite food Italian, you get the string pasta. Great. Right. So and then, you know, algebraic data types can have as well, you can use building types. So you can declare constructors. We take building types or other types as elements when they construct a value of the data type. In this case, you know, I define a tree of integers, which, you know, is either a leaf with an integer there, or is a node where the left subtree is a tree of integer and the right subtree is a tree of integer, right? And this is an example, you know, this is the tree, yeah. So let me see, how can I fix this? Give me a second. To remember the, just give me a second. Some work. Okay. So, yeah. So now, see, yeah. Still, I hope it still is big enough. Yeah. So here is a tree that, you know, has a, you have a node here. And then on the left-hand side, this, right? Then you have 42, another node, and then you have 42, and then here you have 10, right? And here you have, right? So this is the way, you know, that we represent, this is the tree that we are represented in X by this value, right? So please, if this is not basic for you, please let me know. I'm assuming that it's quite basic. So yeah. All right, so yeah, you can do trees of strings as well, where, you know, we now the binary tree doesn't use integers in the leaves, but they use strings, but the structure is the same. Right, and then, you know, we can generalize this and have a polymorphic abstract data type where the definition of the data type is parameterized by a type variable A, which means that, you know, this algebraic data type is polymorphic. It means like it represents binary trees where the leaves can have any value of any type, right? But they all, you know, given a tree, they all need to coincide. Right, so yeah. Right, that was the quick introduction. Any questions?
Well, no? not yet, but they were just okay. Like more okay with the without the break. So I think that probably you can go without the break. That's the
okay. Thanks, Sylvia. Yeah, we go without the break. Yeah. All right. So. All right, so, oh, sorry. Yeah. All right, so, yeah. So that was a quick recap of or introduction what Haskell does. Again, in the webpage, you have, you know, you have the link how to install Haskell, you have access to the code and so on and so forth. If you have trouble with this, please write in the Slack channel and I do my best to reply you, you know, to keep you going. Right. And we'll skip all this part because that's the part that we just were seeing here. Right. So why we are using Haskell for security, and this is kind of the, because it's a pure language, I will make explicit what I mean by that in a second. But in theory, you could use any pure language. But the important thing of Haskell has is like has an advanced type system. And as I said before, that is pure, right? So if you have any other language that is pure and have an advanced type system, then you could implement these libraries as well. There is no reason why it should not work. Right. So let me show you the aspect of Haskell that we will use for this course. And the first here I'm going to keep it very simple in the beginning. So I'm going to use super old feature of Haskell, of the type system. But then in some lectures we will use more advanced ones. So, you know, the first one is related with overloading. And here we have like an overloading function, which is called BCMP for comparing. You give two variables, X and Y, and you need to compare if they're equal, right? So what is the type of that function, right? So we could say, well, maybe it's the type A to A bool, you know, give me two elements, two integers, and I return a Boolean. Give me two floats, and then I return a Boolean because I know how to compare floats, I know how to compare integers. Give me two characters, and I know how to compare them, right? But the problem that we have, if we give this type to that function, is like the type A is too liberal here. You know, it's any possible type that you can think of, you can replace it where you have the A on the screen. Right, so, but not every value of a given type can be compared with equality. Can you give me an example of that? Can you give me a type that you cannot compare by equality so easily? Or that is very hard to compare with equality?
A matrix, for example, a matrix or a vector? You can define an equality, but you can't. There's no automatic concept of equality for a vector or a matrix in general. You can compare them.
You need to start putting restrictions, like the vector should have the same size, and the elements within the vector needs to be comparable. Yeah,
exactly. That's right.
But a more traditional example is like functions, right? So if you have functions conceptually, to compare them means like you need to apply the function in all the possible points, right? Which might take you a long time to do it, right? So you give me two functions from, you know, 64-bit integers to 64-bit integer, it will take you a lot of time to compare if they're equal, because you need to go through all, you need to apply the function for all the domain, right? All right, so how Haskell resolve this? So it kind of add what is called type constraints, which what you see here in this here, you know, on the left-hand side of this symbol. It means like the A's that you put here are not any possible A, are A's which satisfies the type constraint EQ, that means equality. It's a way to characterize only those types that support equality, and the compiler knows how to implement that equality, right? And in Haskell, you can declare your own type classes. The type classes give origin to type constraints, right? So when we here, we, you know, we can declare a type class EQA, and then we just need to provide what is called a method. So, and then the compiler knows, okay, this is a type constraint, right? And the type constraint means like, okay, this kind of restrict the A to those that support equality, that support an implementation of this equality function here, right? So, and you know, for example, Haskell compiler has an instance of this type class for integers, where you need to implement the equality for integers, and then you have an instance for example, equality of list of any type, provided that you support equality of the elements of that list, right? So then you can start playing games like this with the type classes. Okay, this is not related with the classes and objects on the object of the programming. This is just like the terminology that we use here, right? So a type class gives origins to a type constraint that is used to restrict the polymorphic variables to those that provide an implementation of the methods in the type class, right? It's a it's a principal way to support polymorphism. Sorry, not polymorphism, overloading. Yeah, in the presence of polymorphism. Yeah. All right. So far, this is a kind of the only one that advanced feature, you know, advanced feature, which is rather old, but it's advanced still that you need to learn. All right. So, and the second aspect of Haskell is that it's pure, right? But let me be clear with this, what I mean to be pure. Yeah. So, in a pure functional language, for example, you have this function double that goes from integer to integer, that you give it an x, and then you return the double, the double of that value, which is x plus x, right? And here, so you compute the value, there is no other effects. You give me the input and I give you the output, right? That's it. The meaning of what the function is computing depends on the sub-expressions only. There is no global state that I'm looking at and so on, or things like that, right? So, and the variables here are variables in the sense of unknown quantities. So I know that X is unknown, but it's not, that's kind of like in math, right? So it's an unknown variable. So it's a variable with an unknown value, right? So, yeah. And then when you see the value of the function, when you see the X in different places, you are talking about the same unknown quantity, right? And if you have that, you know what you have, what is known as referential transparency, like the value of an expression depends on the sub-expressions only, right? And then when you see a variable X in the expression and you see, you know, the next X next to it, like in this case, you know that you're talking about the same X. I'm being a little bit informal here, but, you know, just to give you the intuition. And then, you know, we have this piece of C code here that implements the same function. Right? So implement the same function. So here we see that the plus plus breaks referential transparency, right? Because, you know, there are effects, and now the X all of a sudden are not referring to the same values. On the X on the left hand side and on the right hand side, they're not referring to the same thing, right? So we broke referential transparency. So we want to be pure, we want to have referential transparency, we want to reason about programs like we reason in math. When you know, in math, you write f of x equal and a formula, you know that x is the x that the function took. It didn't change along the way. So, all right. And then the question is like, well, yeah, sure. We it's okay to be pure, it's great. You know, we can reason about programs, but, you know, the programs, they need to produce effects. They need to kind of communicate with the external world. Right. Otherwise, it's just warm up the computer, and you see that the computer is getting warm, but you don't see any what is getting, you don't get any interaction, right? Right. So and then we show you like how Haskell is solving this problem of being pure, but it's still supporting to reason about the effects, right? And it's a little bit complicated, it's a little bit subtle, but it's very important that you get it right, because the whole world, well, one of the reasons why the security libraries work is because how Haskell managed to be pure and still support dealing with effects, right? Imagine you have this function, inputs, you give it like no arguments, and it will ask a user to input for some input, right? Right, so if I have a piece of program where input appear many times, so it means like every occurrence of that input might refer to a different input string. It could be like, you know, when the first input gets executed, the user put a string X, and then when the second input gets executed, the user put a string Y, and so on, right? So then the code, we lost this referential transparency, right? So we are more in like in C, like the example in C. All right. So how can we reconcile that? How can we reconcile effects while still being pure? Right. So So what we need to think about is that when we were seeing this piece of code and we were thinking in this piece of code, as I just said to you, we are thinking like input parentheses, you know, denotes as a string. That's what we are thinking. Denote a string. So in every occurrence of the input, I need to ask the user immediately to give me the string. So the side effect is triggered immediately, right? That's how say does it, for example. Right? But that's not how Haskell does it. Yeah. So in Haskell, has a strong discipline to separate code that is effect-free and code that has effects and interaction with the standard world. And that discipline, that separation, that segregation is enforced by the type system. Okay. So you could, if we were in an impure language, you will think that input has the following type, takes no arguments and produces a string. Right? Right, because you know we say that you know we were thinking like when you, the input with no arguments denotes a string, right? So if that's the case, clearly it's a function that returns a string. But then we don't want to produce effect right away, right? We don't want to produce it right away as in C, because if we do that, then every occurrence of input might refer to different strings, and then we lose referencing transparency. And yeah, when you see the type of string, it's a string. It's just a string. It's not, there's no effects there. Right. So what should be the type of input then? And you know, it took the Haskell community many, many years to figure this out in the way that I'm going to present you. Now it's common knowledge, but we took a while. So what you do is like, okay, we don't think the call to the input as denoting a string, okay? So now if it's not denoting a string, so input now has a type, when you apply it to the empty argument, it has a type IO string, right? This type IO string, it means it's not an string, is a description of the effects that will happen at runtime, right? So now the side effects are going to be typed with this IO thing, IO string, which is a description and a script. You can think it as a script that will execute it at runtime. And as a result of that, execution, it will return a string. And then, yeah, the way that you should think about this is like something of type IO string is a script, a small piece of program, right? It's a small piece of program that when executed at runtime, it will ask the user for an string. That's how you should think. Any questions?
Not yet, I mean.
Okay, good. Right, so now when we see all the different occurrences of these inputs here, they're all referring to the same script to be executed at runtime. Okay? So now, because you know it's not the type of string, it's the type IO string. So it's the same piece of small program that will execute it at runtime. So it's the same piece of code, if you wish. Right? So we don't have the problem that the different occurrences of input might refer to different values. No, they're referring to the same value here. It's the piece of code to be executed at runtime to ask the user for a string. All right. But okay, but when are the effects being triggered then, right? Right, so when we have something of type IO string, it's called an IO action, right? It's called an IO action because you know it's a piece of code that when executed at runtime, it will do some input and output, right? So imagine, and for this, you know, to answer the question, like when this get executed, you know, I will show you some piece of code. You know, assuming that we have these three different variables with different types, you know, two strings and something of type IO string. And I'm oversimplifying things here, but in Haskell, you will have the heap, you have these different values. In the heap, you don't have type information, but here I just put the type information just for the sake of simplicity, for explaining. In the heap, you have these three variables, and you have the Haskell runtime that, you know, when you're executing your program, it will start kind of reducing expressions in order to perform computations, right? Which is called the evaluation process. Great. So, for example, imagine that you are, you know, the Haskell runtime is running, it's evaluating your program, and it gets the string. It says, okay, I need to evaluate this string because, you know, it's a lazy language. I didn't say that, sorry, but yeah. It's a lazy language, so evaluates only the piece of the program that you need to compute your result. So imagine that you need to evaluate the y, right? Yeah, you evaluate it, and then, you know, the string evaluated to the string hello, it goes back to the heap in the normal form, right? Hello. Great. But now, when it came something of type IO string, right? The Haskell runtime system realized, this is a piece of program that I need to run to perform effects. At that time, the runtime system will trigger the fact. Okay? And we'll ask the user for an string. And after the string gets obtained from the user, it will go back to the heap, right? Because that's kind of the result that the user provides. Okay, so the message here is like to run effects with the interaction, I input and output interaction, the runtime system, it needs to be that the runtime system needs to evaluate that IO action, that value of type IO sums. Otherwise, it will never evaluate. So let me go 1 second back to the coding. All right, so we have, for example, put the string line. Let me show you the type of put the string line, gets a string, and returns an IO action. This description of what to do when the runtime system needs to evaluate something of type IO, right? So if I do, for example, put a string line, hello, the type of that is IO unit, right? The type of this is IO unit, which means, and I'm asking to the Haskell runtime system now, please evaluate this expression. This expression is of type IO unit, which means it will take this IO action, this description of what to do at runtime, which effects do to runtime, and perform the effect. You see that shows on the screen, hello, right? But look at this. I do like this, I put a string line, hello, in 42. Now the runtime system, we built an IO action, X is of type IO unit. We built an IO action, but the runtime system never needed to reduce it. Therefore, it never will trigger the effect, right? So here we just return 42. Okay, you see the difference, right? So we built the IO action, we built a description of what it will happen when the runtime system needs to evaluate that expression. So we can ask the runtime system to say, please evaluate here. The runtime system needs to evaluate the pair 42, comma X. And X is an IO action. And look, see what happens. It didn't evaluate it. Right? Why? Well, because the IO action is inside the pair. And here we are lazy, right? So in order to evaluate that effect, I need to project it from the pair. If I do like this, then the runtime system will execute the IO action because it needs to evaluate it. There you go, hello. Okay. So yeah, so you know that when the runtime system finds an IO action, you know, at the top level, not inside a data structure, just at the top level, it will evaluate it and it will produce effects. Back to the slides. Yeah. All right. All right. So then, yeah. So now, yeah, we recovered reference and transparency. Now, when we see a program, when you see a program, before executing it, it's a pure program. You know, you have variables, expressions that compute things, you know, adding integer, removing integer, and you have a lot of description of things that what will happen at runtime, right? So this separation was makes Haskell give the capacity to be pure and still reason about programs in a pure way, even in the presence of effects. Now, when I see the program, I see input here, it's the same value. It's a description of how to do the input once the runtime needs it, right? So I can reason with the program, like if IO actions are just numbers are like integers or strings, there is no difference. Now, when we go to runtime, it's a different story, right? And this is super important for the security libraries. All right. All right. So, as I said before, Haskell kind of separates by the type system code that is side effect free and code that is side effectful. And I ask to you, if you need to write code and you want to be sure that that code doesn't leak information, which of these two segments you will feel more comfortable with? The code that is side effect free or the code that is side effectful? Which one you would like to write your program in which segment?
Side effect free,
great, yes. Yeah, because then you know that your secret is not going, you know, through the network and so on. You know that it's contained in your computer. Very good, yeah. So a side effect free code is intrinsically safe, right? So the problem is you need to consider effects. Right? And now we can say effects for us is anything of type IOA, because that's kind of the type that Haskell used for the, representing any possible side effects that you can do with external world. Right. So now, I go more into the PL parts that, the type IOA is a monad, which means, can I get a quick reaction? Who knows what a monad is? Maybe you've seen it in a different course. If you say app or the heart, then I know that you know that. Yes. All right, not everyone, yeah. All right. Okay, let me give you the simple, popular definition of the monad. Right, so that's right. Essentially, IOA is a monad, and everything that has type IOA for some A, I will say that it's a monadic computation or it's a monadic value, right? So just to refer to something in the language, so a term level that has type IOA, in this case, IOA from a monad, right? Right, and what does it mean to be a monad? This is in a super brief way. It has Being a monad, it means that you have an interface to build programs, to build something of the type IOA. You have two primitives. The first one is return. Return is a primitive that produces no side effects. It's side effect free and give you something of type IOA, right? So yeah, we can go to the code here, right? So we say, we can say like, let me see, return 10. Let me ask for the type, return 10. Okay, so I say I want return A to be IO int, right? So that's a way to say like return A, as you see here, return, you give it a value, I give you something in the monad, in the monad IO, right? But it didn't do any side effects. It didn't print a screen, it didn't ask the user for a string, anything, just like a pure thing. Right, so the way to see, maybe, yeah, okay, I have to show you, let me go back to the slides, yeah. So yeah, so you have return, that just give a value and give you a computation that produced that value, but produce no side effects. And then we have, which is a more interesting one, is called bind. It essentially takes, it's used for sequentialized computations. It takes a computation, a monadic computation that might produce some side effects, and we'll take the result of that computation, and we give you the computation that takes the result of the first computation and apply it to a function that you give it as a second argument to the bind to tell you how you follow, how you should follow your program, your monadic program. Let me go back to the code. Right, and let me show you the type. This is a symbol for bind. Right, you take a monadic computation, M of A. Here you can think M and like IO, right? It's an IO computation. And you take a function, which is like the continuation. It's like, give me the result of the first computation and I will apply this function to know how, what I should do next. And what shall I do next is here represented by the monadic computation M of P. Right, and it returns M on B. So it takes a little bit of getting used to, but you should think like M of B. What the bind returns is a computation that give you a B, which is that B is obtained by running this computation, taking the result of that computation and applying this function. Okay, we will see examples in a second. Yeah. Yeah, but that's as you see here, you know, we sequentialize instructions. So the this one allows me to sequentialize things. Take the result of this computation and then apply the continuation to see how I follow. So I can put things in a sequential order than using the bind. All right. So yeah. So, and here is an example that we can do. We can go back to the code. Go here. I'm sorry, let me do this a little bit bigger. Right, so as you see here, the greetings is a IO computation, IO action that doesn't produce any result, it's just unit. So and what it does, right, let me write this in a slightly different way, it's in the bind. So then it says greetings is equal to the string line, welcome, what's your name, right? Remember the type of that, it gives me a description of a computation that when executed at runtime, it will produce a unit. So it's not very interesting, the unit, right? So I can do bind here. And now I write how the computation should follow, describing a function, right? So I would say, I don't care about the unit because I know the first computation, the first IO action will return a unit. So I don't care about this. And what I do next is I will ask the user for an string. And this is done with the function getLine. GetLine is a IO action that when executed, it will produce a string. It will return a string. We see getLine here. I can say hello. It's asking me for the screen. And then this is the thing that will produce, the thing that will return. Hello, yeah. So this hello is about running the script, the IO action, and this is what it produces. I can say getLine, right? And then how should I continue? Well, you can use the bind again. This is an IO string. This is of type IO string. Right? So I can say, well, give me that string. I'll call it the name. I'll call it, you know, that string is the name of the user. And then I can say hi to that user. Welcome. And put the name of the user. Let me see. Let me put the parentheses excessively careful. Just so now I create a program that kind of concatenates using the bind three IO actions. Right? Let's see if this compiles. So now I can call to greetings. I would say, welcome, what's your name? Alejandro. Welcome, I should fix it here. Welcome, Alejandro. Right, so now it works, okay? You can see how this bind operator allow me to put simple IO actions together to create more complex programs. This is one IO action, this is another IO action, and this is, and I repeat, I used to print the string there. Print the string line again. So working with the bind sometimes gets, you know, gets some time to get used to thinking this way, to think about, you know, an IO action and then writing a function that takes the result of the IO action and tell me how to continue, right? And how to continue is running an IO action, another IO action, and, you know, using the bind again to capture the result and see how it continues, so on and so forth, right? All right, so, but then Haskell has what is called the do notation, which essentially allow me to kind of skip the bind and just flip the arrows. So here I have this one, the underline, this means like, I don't care about the result. So this one, I can remove it. And what I can do, I can take this, maybe I should write it in a slightly different way. Just give me a second. So I'm just reordering the code. So you see what I'm going to do. I put the function here. Just reordering the thing. That compile should compile. Yeah. So I just reordering the code just a little bit, just so you see what I'm going to do now. So yeah. So it has a do notation that essentially says, okay, I'm using the bind. Yeah, this is what you are this is the bind, you know, where you bind the result of the computation. So then here we say like, I don't care. And you put and you put the IO action, and then you just remove this. And then here you are binding the result of get line into name. So we put name here. And we just keep get line and remove the bind. Basically here there is no more bind, so I don't put anything there. Yeah. So and that's still a valid program and compiles. So yeah, we can use a do notation instead of using the bind, right? So and the idea is like on the right-hand side of the arrow, you put the computation, the IO action you want to execute, and then here you bind the result of that IO action. And then you just write one instruction after the other one, right? And now it looks super sequential. Like it looks like almost like imperative programming, like using semicolon, right? But we are using the bind underneath. Yeah, so that's right. And then we can as well write functions, which, produce a string here. For example, it will ask, this is a program that it will ask, what is your first name? Right, you get that as an input and you put it in name. Then you will run, what is your last name? You get that as an input. And then you produce, the thing that you produce out of those, this interaction is a concatenation of your first name and your last name, right? So as full name, if we see here, it's something of IO string. It will do a lot of interaction. As a result of that interaction, it will produce a string. So we say as full name, first name, Alejandro Russo. And after all this interaction finished, it produces a string, Alejandro Russo. And then we can write this other more complex program, welcome. Say welcome to the system. Ask for the full name in these two interactions. And the result of that interaction is a string, full name. It's a full name. So I do the interactions, I get those values from the interaction, and then I combine it and produce the full name. And then I say hello, full name. Right. Say welcome. Say what's your first name? Alejandro Russo. Then says hello, Alejandro Russo. Okay. So this is a quick way to show you like how you program in a monadic style using the return and the bind and some existing functions of type IO that represents the interaction with the system. You have the code, you can download it and play it. You know, sometimes take some time to get used to it, but you can play with it at your discretion. Yeah. All right, so this is more or less all what I was saying. All right, so why I was showing all of this, it is like, now, if you want to write a secure program, and you know that everything that does interactions, IO interaction with the external world, is of type IO something, because that's how Haskell identifies effects with the external world, then what I can do is I can say, well, please write me a program using this type, which is a security type that makes sure that there is no IO in that type. If I know that there is no IO, I know that the user is not arbitrarily performing any effects, because you know within the monad IO, you can perform any effects that you wish. But the program will be built using some security types. And the idea is like, if you use all the security types and you don't see IO in any place, we will make sure that because you're using all security types, the only IO that the program will execute, the only interaction that will execute, are the ones that are saved. So it's a way to wrap up to say, okay, if you use effects, IO appears in the type, okay, that's not good. Okay, but I give you my own type, which is a wrapper of I/O. It's a wrapper. But the way that you build your program using my security type will guarantee that the underlying I/O actions are safe to execute. And we will see exactly how to do this. All right. So, and why a monad? Our security type is going to be a monad as well. So it's going to use this return and bind. And why is that? Well, because underneath is going to be I/O, those I/O actions which are safe to execute. And because underlying structure is a monad, it's more natural to have the wrapper to be a monad as well. Right. And let me go to the running example, and then we can stop after this. So the running example is like you are Alice, you are developing a password manager, and that's what we do in the course. And you know, as any password manager, you want to refrain user, you want to avoid the users chooses commonly guessed password like 1234, right? Because that's not good. What you need to do as a developer, okay, you need to say, well, I need to look for dictionaries of commonly used password. You need to do you need to implement that part of the password manager. But it turns out that there is a module out there that does exactly that. That if you give a password, it checks if it's easy to guess. But that password has been developed by the ninja. Of course, you don't know that, right? This kind of mimics the scenario where you, as a developer, just grab some module from the internet and want to use it in your system, right? You don't know if it was written by a ninja or not, right? And then, of course, the password manager is going to handle the password that the users choose to log in into the system. And you need to give that password to the module that the ninja wrote in order for the ninja module to fulfill his purpose, which is answer you if it's a commonly guessed password. Of course, you are not sure if by doing that, the password are not being leaked to the ninja server. Okay? And this is kind of the questions. This is a question that I will ask you. Imagine more concretely, let me move myself. Yeah, go here. Imagine that, from that module, you want to use the following function, which is called common. And the type of that function is as follows. It goes from a string to bool. Question to you. Would you use that function? Give me some reactions, thumbs up or not. You will use that function if you were Alice. You should think this is a code that is effect free, or has some effects. Right, so a few say like you will use that code, yes, because it's a pure code. It's a effect free code. In the types, there is no I/O, right? So it's a string to bool. So so that's safe to use. But it's quite limited because, for example, it means like the check for the commonly guessed passwords is hard coded there. Because there is no I/O whatsoever, so it's hard coded into the module. So the ninja module doesn't enable for dictionary updates. Okay, it's safe to use, but it's limited. It means that you, as a developer of the password manager, need to somehow be aware that you're always checking against the same easy to guess passwords. All right, what about this? What about if it has this type, a string to I/O bool? Would you use that function? Will you give your password to the ninja module? Okay, so people are saying no. Danger. Yeah, it's dangerous. Why is dangerous? Why? What can happen?
It does arbitrary I/O, including connecting arbitrary servers on the internet.
That's right. Or so we see the I/O.
I'll try reading passwords. File, or better yet, secret file, if you Yeah.
So it has the IO up there. So because it has the IO up there, it means I can do any side effects. So you can get your password and send it over the internet, right? Right. So it seems like the problem is like, you know, IO is giving too much power to if the ninja is using IO, is giving too much power. So this is kind of could be like one way to implement the password. So give me a second, I need to check some stuff. I'm thinking, you know, I'm checking if we can cut here 2 minutes before or So imagine that, okay, we can, you know, we may finish like at 22, something like this. I hope that's okay. So yeah, so this is kind of one way, one possible implementation of the password manager. You know, you are Alice, right? And you import the ninja code, which is called Bob. So every time that you see Bob in the code, it means like I'm calling the code of the ninja. And the password manager is super simple. It's an IO action string. And then it's like it's an IO action because it will ask the user to select a password. It will get the password using getLine. I will get a password here. This is the string that the user input. And then I'm giving that password to the common function that we were just chatting about. And that returns me a Boolean and tell me if it's an easy to guess password or it's a strong password, right? If the Boolean is true, then it's too common. And then I just repeat the loop. I call the function again. Otherwise, I return the password. That's the password that the user can use in the system. Of course, the problem is there, right? So, and if Bob, as we said before, has the IO there, right? It can fetch dictionary updates. Fine, yes, it can fetch dictionary updates, this model. That's super cool, but as well can send everything on the internet. So it seems like, you know, IO is too powerful. So what about if instead of using the monad IO, the ninja is using a monad like, similar to IO, but only allowed from one side effect, which is fetching dictionary updates. Right? The only thing that I can do is like fetch dictionary updates. Will you use that function? Give me some. Will you still use the function or not? I have only one side effect. It only allows to fetch dictionary updates. Unfortunately, that's not enough because you can still encode information about the password in the request for the dictionary updates. If you are doing a HTTP request or whatever, in the request, you can encode some information about the password that you are seeing. Okay? Even if you have only one side effect, it's a problem. So what we need, actually, is, let me move back. Yeah, what we need, actually, it's not about the power, you know, that you have, but it's like when you use it. Right, so what we need is a monads that kind of allow you to do any side effects that you want. But as soon as the code observes some secrets, some sensitive information, the effects are reduced to those that do not leak information. Okay, so what we're going to see in this course, like we provide monads, a family of monads, that allow you to do precisely that. Being free, give you hands-free. If your code has not observed any secrets, allow you to do anything. But as soon as you see a secret, it will allow you to do only effects that we can be sure that will not leak information. And so now we'll show you this security library called MAC, which is based in a functional pair that I wrote in 2015, because it's a simple way to explain these concepts. And what we're going to do is like ask Bob to give us his or her code using the types exposed by the security library, right? And we know that we type check the code, then we have certain guarantees that the library doesn't leak information. And we will see that we can handle a rich number of features like references, exceptions, concurrency, and synchronization primitives like mbars. We will do all of this in less than around 200 lines of code. And if you compare what we are going to do with these 200 lines of code, compared with the other tools that I showed that I mentioned in the beginning, we are doing way a lot for that little amount of code, because we are leveraging a lot on the infrastructure that Haskell already has there, because we phrase this as a library, so that's great. And since simplicity is key for this work, and we will keep it simple, we will use Haskell 98 or 2010. I think in the code is 2010. And then two Haskell extensions only, multi-parameter type classes and say Haskell. You know, Haskell has different extensions that enable different features of the type system. We will keep it super simple, right? And I think I will stop here. Is that okay, right? So that's, I can ask, can ask me some questions if you have, but I will stop here, and tomorrow we will see how to do this, how to implement this library. Is there any questions?
Actually, there were like one, two questions, but there were answers by fellow members. But there is one question that been asked, and I think I can give a more clear answer about that. Someone asked that, are there more conservative versions of IO?
Conservative
versions of IO.
Conservative in what sense? That's
gonna, I think if he or she is going to make it clear by himself, that would be more okay. Yeah, I think Christopher asked if you want, meaning it can do less than IO can do.
Yeah, sure. There are versions of that. But again, the question is like, if you have a small set of effects that you can support, less of everything that you can do with IO, still we need to deal with this problem of you allow any effects, you can allow any effects to do while you haven't observed any sensitive information, but as soon as you observe sensitive information, you need to select which effects will not leak information. Yeah.
Good. And we have a hand raised by Joy, I think you want to ask. Well, okay, you can unmute and.
Yeah, sure.
I was just wondering on the web page for the course, you've linked some literature and complementary reading. I wondered, just wanted to know if there was any of that we should take a look at before tomorrow.
For tomorrow, let me see. So you have a list of in the web page, the list of papers that the course is based on, and then you have some extra ones. The extra one is only if you really want to. Tomorrow. Things. I think for tomorrow, if you can read the functional pair, I think that's the easy entry point for this course. And then if you want to read as well, flexible dynamic information flow control in presence of exceptions as a second, the first one was super easy, then go to the second one. Otherwise, no. Otherwise, just read the functional pair.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Professor, sorry. You mean essentially this right? Module two part, you know, in syllabus. So what are you talking about just now?
So we're still in module one. So for the module one, you're still just read the functional pair. We're still halfway on the module one.
Okay.
We see, you know, because, you know, I'm doing live coding, so that's usually taking a little more time. So just read the functional pair, and then
module one. All right, thank you.
Yeah, so I think tomorrow we finish with that, and probably we start with something on the module two. Yeah.
Okay, we have a raised hand by another guy, I think. Something. Yeah, can unmute.
The question I had is, usually type systems are static, but policies could change dynamically. How do you think about those?
Right, that's a good question. You remember when I showed the slide with the different libraries, right? So there are static versions of it, there is dynamic version of it, and there is a hybrid version of it, right? So usually the ones that are more practical, if you wish, are the dynamic one, precisely for this reason. Because, when we will see tomorrow as well, like when some information comes in, you might not know a problem, you know, if that information is sensitive, and if it's sensitive, to whom that information is sensitive, right? That might be some dynamic. So here we will see that the static policy, because of the simplest to reason about. But all the principles that we'll see in this course will apply almost naturally to the dynamic setting, except for some differences that I will explain in the course.
Okay, there is one question, I think, in the chat. So let me see. They said, like, in addition to the Haskell, any other languages have good infrastructure for controlling side effect? If you would like to answer this, I mean.
And as I said before, you know, everyone that is pure, as I was saying, and supports side effects, should be able to do it. I think Agda could do it. I'm not super expert like when it comes to IO and Agda, but my understanding is like it works. But that's a dependently type setting. But I mean, you need to kind of be pure and be able to reason about side effects at the same time, as I was showing you the lecture. If you can do that, then you're off to go. Yeah.
Thank you. I think that's all for today's questions. I think no more questions we have, but if anyone has questions, they can ask in Slack as well. Maybe Professor will follow you there.
Okay. All right. Let's thank Alejandro for the great lecture.
Thanks.
And I think there's going to be time for about a 10-minute break before we start the second lecture of today. Before you go, Alejandro, could you pass back the host controls to us?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I'm super happy. Yeah, I make you host Paul. Yeah,
great.
Thanks. All right, I can leave. Thanks a lot, guys, and thanks a lot for the questions. And see you tomorrow.